Good morning, believers. Praise the Lord. Wow. Can you fix me up a little bit? Thanks. Man, it's just good to be here at the house of the Lord. We were here last night with Chris Webb. Our Saturday night service, we just have a blast. I love what God is doing. There's a hunger that's being stirred up within the body. There's an expectation that the believers are having, that they're stepping into something. And what I like about it is they're getting a revelation, and I'm seeing this more and more each day, where people are just walking out what God is really, what God is doing in their life. A few things going on this week. Keep in mind that Saturday morning we're having our men's breakfast. Also, the Wednesday night meals are discontinued for the summer, and we'll be picking it up again right after Labor Day. But our Wednesday night services, we're still having it here in all different Bible studies. We encourage you to come out on Wednesday nights and be part of that. As you notice, that we all have our God is Good t-shirts. There's a family, the Martz family. They're going through a tough time with Caleb, who was diagnosed with a cancer. And this is just in order to support that family as they're going through this. We do have t-shirts available out in the lobby. So if you want to be part of that, I think they're so cool, though. And I'm sure this is going to stir up a lot of conversations as we walk into different places like, you know, the Rutters and the Walmarts and just go around town and just let people know that, man, you know what? God is good. I don't think that my God is as good as your God. Because if it was, you guys would get a little bit more excited about God is good. Come on, God is good.
Amen.
Come on, let's stand. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you because we know, Lord God, that even through this part of our service this morning, Lord God, that people will be set free, they'll be healed, they'll hear from you, Lord God. Their eyes will be open. They'll be able to understand things that they just didn't have understanding, Lord. Right now, Lord God, we just welcome your presence here, Lord God. We pray that you would just come in like a flood, Lord.
Amen.
That you would take us into deeper waters, Lord God. Lord, we want more. We want to step into the more, Lord God. We bless you. We thank you, Lord God. And we welcome what you have for our lives. We embrace the change that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Come on, let's clap. Yeah. Come on, let's sing it together. My soul longs.
My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else. My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do. My My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. I believe. Come on.
I believe you will come like rain. I believe you will come
like rain.
Like rain.
Yeah, I believe.
I believe you will come like rain.
Say, I believe. Come on, let's sing. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Come on, I believe.
I believe you will come like rain. I believe you will come like rain.
I believe, yeah.
I believe that you will come like rain.
Say you'll come like the rain.
You'll come like the rain. You'll come like the rain. You'll come like the rain. You'll come like the rain.
You'll come like the rain. You'll come like the rain. It's all right, come on, clap, clap.
Just lift your hands. Just lift your hands.
Let it rain, Jesus. Let it rain over us. Let it rain. Yeah, God, let it rain. One more time.
Your voice and say,
and I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in all, yeah. Say, I will stand.
So, Lord,
because all I am is yours.
Stand
with arms high.
Come on, one more time.
And I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrender. All I am is yours.
Come on, one more time, as high as you can. Come on, sing.
I'll stand.
Come on, come on.
See, I will stand, I will stand, 'cause all I am, Jesus, we will stand in awe of the one.
Your voice.
Spirit, break out.
Heaven, come down.
Heaven, come down.
Come on, just you guys. Spirit, break out. Come on. Heaven, come down.
Heaven, come down. Yeah. Our Father, all of heaven roars your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth. Of heaven touching earth, our Father.
Come on.
All of heaven roars your name, sing louder.
Let this place erupt with praise.
Let this place erupt
come on.
With praise.
Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth.
Voice, come on. See, Spirit, break out. Come on.
Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out.
Heaven, come down.
Heaven, come down.
Spirit, We're not going to sing it. We're going to declare it. Come on. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Come on. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Come on. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Come on. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down.
Our Father.
Our Father. All of heaven, rose your name. Sing loud.
Come on, I can't hear you. Come on.
Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it?
The sound.
The sound of heaven.
The sound. The sound.
What's it sound like when heaven touches earth? What's the sound of heaven touching earth right where you're at right now? What's it look like when heaven touches you? What's it look like when heaven touches someone through you? Because the will of God isn't just for heaven to touch you. The will of God is that heaven touches you and you change the earth. Oh, you're called to be His hands extended. You're called to be His feet. What's it look like when heaven touches earth? Today I look around the room and I see a lot of these shirts that say God is good. Hi. She got one. Here's the reality of that. I love this, but listen. God wants to touch. And I believe He wants to touch through you. I know there's a lot of reverb in the house right now. It's probably the anointing. Listen, because there's a place where we have to understand heaven so wants to touch through you. What does that look like in your life? The reason a lot of folks have these shirts on today is because of support for a young man. And it's Kenny's little brother, Caleb. And he's with us right now. And I'm asking heaven to come and touch earth. I'm asking that you would join your heart with me. I am so convinced. I know a cure for cancer. His name is Jesus. I know this. I know that it's the will of God that we see cancer crushed in this community. And I know that's the heartbeat of heaven right now. And I would love to say, let's get 900 of you to gather around Him and we'll lay hands on Him. But that would be a mistake, really. And I just want to say that the right way. I'm going to take his hands. I'm going to pray for him. But I want you to extend your faith with me. Caleb, would you come here, buddy? Come on, man. My heart's really moved. This guy's walking this thing out, man. He's walking it out with integrity and sincerity. And I'm in faith that God wants to touch him. I'm in faith that it's not a coincidence that he'd be here this morning and we'd have this privilege and this opportunity to lay hands on Caleb. So we're just going to believe God right now. Would you join your heart with me? We've just sang prophetically, let heaven touch earth. We've sang that song because we believe that heaven wants to touch earth. There's a place where heaven touches earth. How does heaven touch earth? Through the hands of his people. Through the hands of his people. It's through you and I. And I believe that God wants to touch him. So would you join your heart with me as we just pray? Father, in Jesus' name, we lay our hands upon this young man, and I thank you for Caleb. I thank you for strength and integrity rising up in him. But God, I thank you that even more so, it's your love that makes the difference. It's your love manifested. Your love was manifested on Golgotha's Hill 2,000 years ago. And Lord, you took the stripes upon your back for Caleb's healing. You took the stripes upon him, Lord, that he might be free. So God, we rebuke the cancer right now in Jesus' name. We speak to the blood counts, every cell, every fiber of his being coming into divine alignment, God. It's your will, it's your plan, it's your purpose. And we speak, be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed in the name of the Most High. God, I thank you. Cancer has to bow at the name of Jesus. Get out of his body. Go now in Jesus' name. Every bit of cancer, get out right now in Jesus' name by the authority of the Word, the Spirit, the power, the blood, and the name that's above every name. So, Father, we decree and declare over him healing and wholeness. God, not only for the cancer to go, but wholeness to come and every part of his body coming in divine alignment, God. Complete redemption like he never even had a problem. Redemption's like it never even touched him. God, I speak life and blessing over Caleb now in Jesus' name. Strength come, healing come, wholeness come, fullness come. God, I decree wholeness in the name of the Lord Jesus. God, I thank you. Every bit whole in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thanks, buddy. It's a privilege to pray with you. Thank you. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. I'm just so convinced there's a place, man, where God just wants to touch earth all through us, through his people. And I would challenge you today, man, what do you got to do to be a conduit for heaven to flow through you? For heaven to touch through your life? It's not just through sickness or disease or healings and the charisma gifts. Sometimes it's just loving the stranger on the street and heaven's flowing through you. Sometimes it's just through a hug, through a smile, through a touch, through a handshake. God wants to touch through you. We're going to talk a whole lot about that today as we begin to start a program called Activate Love, because love has to look like something. And we'll talk about that in a few moments. I just feel Jesus into place. There's an atmosphere right now that's conducive to the presence of the Lord. God wants to touch through you. Oh, can you join hands with somebody right now? Father, touch through us. We join our hands as a community of believers, God. We join our hands and we join our hearts as a community of your people, God, with one desire, that you would flow through us and make us, Lord, an open gate of heaven. God, that the world around us might see and know and sense and have an awareness, God, that you're alive and well, living in this community because you're touching through your people. Holy Spirit, we welcome you right now. Just come. Come in an amazing way. Come in an amazing fashion. Touch hearts and lives. Bring transformation, God. Heaven come down. Heaven come down. That we might know what it looks like when heaven touches earth. Lord, we're asking, just manifest. Heaven came down 2,000 years ago. We're asking, Lord, rise up in us and manifest in the world around us, through us, to touch the world. God, I thank you that we have this great privilege to live in this area, this time, this season, to see heaven touch earth. God, we're in faith to believe right now for heaven touching earth. God, we're in faith right now. Touch through us, Lord. Touch through us, Jesus. Touch through us, God. Let heaven come and touch earth. Bring transformation, God. Bring healing and restoration. Bring help and renewal. Bring encouragement, God. God, you're a good God, and we stand in faith and we agree with you right now for heaven to touch earth, for radical transformation, radical change. God, that you would so move through us and we would be a people, God, so sensitive and so aware of your presence, so sensitive to what the Holy Spirit's wanting to speak and say and do, that we wouldn't miss you, God, that we would see you in every season, that we would know you, God, that we would experience the fullness of your presence. And God, out of that place, we just become a conduit, an open gate, and heaven flows through us. And because of that, lives are touched. God, because of that, marriages are renewed. Because of that, God, children are born again and saved. And God, prodigals are coming back home because we've become aware of your presence, because we've become sensitive to your Holy Spirit, because we've become that gate that heaven would flow through. God, I thank you for divine restoration. I thank you for renewal, God. I thank you, God, that there's a resurgence in our heart and a great desire in our spirit to see your kingdom come and your will accomplished right here on earth, the same as it is in heaven. So, Lord, we do more than just sing the song today. We do more than just cry and say, let heaven come down, break our walls down. God, we're asking, move in us to such a place, in such a manner, God, that we can't be the same going out today as we were when we came in, because we've been touched by the Spirit of the living God and our lives are being transformed and we're challenged in our core because your Holy Spirit resides in us. God, come. Let us be a community of believers that heaven really flows through. God, we see radical transformation, radical change. Come and touch us, Lord, I pray. Renew us, Lord, I pray. Give us a fresh fire and a great desire, stronger than we've ever known. In Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Bless the Lord. 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 Is it a heart cry for you like it is for me for the Holy Spirit to come and totally radical? I want God to rattle me. I don't even know if that's the right word or not, but I just want that. I want something different. Can we sing that one more time, Jason? Let's do that one more time. Spirit, come down. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down.
I got something better.
Gotcha. Go ahead. Okay, do it. Do it. I'm going to follow you, man. I feel this. There's something that God wants to do right now. Go ahead.
One single breath holds all the weight of your glory.
Come on, Jesus. Come, Lord.
One single breath holds all the weight of your glory. Just one touch and our lives are forever changed. Just one touch and we'll never ever be the same. So breathe on us, God, breathe on us. Yeah, breathe on us, breathe on us.
Come on, one single breath.
One single breath holds all the weight of your glory. One single breath, Jesus, holds all the weight of your glory.
Come on, lift your voice. Just one touch.
Just one touch, and our lives are forever changed.
Come on, lift it up. Just one touch.
Just one touch.
So breathe.
all the weight of your glory. Lift your hands. One single breath, Jesus, holds all the weight of your glory.
Come on, just one touch.
Just one touch, and our lives are forever changed. Just one touch, and we'll never ever be the same. So breathe on us.
Growing up as a kid, and I want you to hear this the right way. In our house, I grew up in an apartment in New York, so the room that we have was limited, if I can say it that way. But my mom and dad's bedroom was off limits to play in. I want you to hear that, because I believe that God, He's speaking to His people, to draw them into a place of intimacy, a place where it's just you, the bride, and the groom. A place of respect, a place of honor, a place where you're saying, this place is off limits. This is a place where I just need to go alone and be with my daddy, to be with my, as the bride gets together with the bridegroom. A place of intimacy where we're able to hear things that's just for our ears to hear. There are certain things that God has spoken to you about that if you're like me, God has not released me to speak some of the things that I've heard in the throne room yet. God wants to share some secrets with his bride. And one of the challenges that I want to just release over the house today and those that are watching through the internet is, man, get into that place of intimacy. Hear from him. Know his thoughts. Know his secrets. Have him guide your day. Let him take you to a place where you've never been before. God is gathering the body together. I've never been surrounded by a group of people that are just so hungry for what God has for their lives. This coming Saturday morning, on the 7th, the men's ministry is going to gather together for breakfast. Men, I encourage you to come out. Iron sharpens iron. There's something about when men get together and start seeking after what God has for them. Men, if I can say it this way, we need one another. I can't walk this thing. There's certain things in my walk I need you to partner with. There are certain things I need to learn from you as men. I encourage you to come out on Saturday morning and join us for the men's breakfast. In today's bulletin, I'm going to be real quick about it. There's a little calendar there. We do this on purpose, just because, especially now coming up with the summer months. Everybody has family plans and has plans. Man, we don't want you to miss out in getting together with the family as well. A few things I just want to highlight here is the Yellow Team on the 15th is having their Yellow Team picnic. We encourage you guys to come out, be part of that. Bill and Tina's phone number is in the bulletin. There's also a sign-up sheet in the Welcome Center that you can sign up. You don't have to be part of the Yellow Team to come out and hang out. Okay, we just want to encourage everyone. It's just a good time right after church on Sunday on the 15th to come and hang out and fellowship and just be together as a family. Once a year, we've been doing this for a few years already, but a group of churches in our community gathered together to sponsor an event called Hope for the City in Gettysburg. A lot of us have partaked, and we've been part of that. I want to encourage you, put that on your calendar to be part. So we want to encourage you to go ahead and put that on your calendar. Also on the 22nd. Pastor Dave and Ms. Kim are having shop talk and chit-chat at their house. There'll be a sign-up sheet at the Welcome Center for that. And again, we just want to see you get involved and be part of the body. At the end of this month, one of the things we've been doing is just having a time where we get together to meet some of the new people that are coming into the house as the pastors. At the end of the month, you'll see here it says new friends meet and greet. There'll be a sign-up sheet for that at the Welcome Center as well. we want to take time just to meet some of the folks that are coming into the church. That way you get to meet the pastors, meet the regional pastors. If you have kids, you'll meet to meet some of the people that are pouring into their lives as well. Amen.
Everybody, I just wanted to say on behalf of the Martz family, these shirts for Caleb, it means so much to us. I just wanted to say on behalf of the Martz family that the shirts that you guys have bought for Caleb, it means more than you will ever know. Our shirts, people in Hawaii, all the way to Florida. Wanted to say thank you. We will be getting more. We are sold out almost again. I will make another order. So far, we have bought 383 shirts. So, as you can imagine, we have done very well with them. I just wanted to make an announcement about the spaghetti dinner. It is June 21st. It's, I believe, in three Saturdays. It's from 4 to 6. It's going to be here at Harvest Chapel. Tickets are $10. Under age 2 is free. I've had questions. It's just spaghetti and salad and some drinks. it's going to be a fun time. There's going to be a bake sale, more of an auction with the baked goods, and then there's going to be raffle items. So lots of places around town have donated for this, so I'm really excited. Once again, tickets are $10, so please see me. My number and my email's in there, so just shoot me a text, or Kenny, you can call him, but he's going to tell you to come to me, so. but thank you guys, it means so much.
If you're in the house and you have one of these lovely shirts on, or you bought one today, let's all stand. Hold up your shirt if you bought one today or if you're in the house. She wants to take a picture. Camera people, can you get some shots of these? Woohoo! Team Caleb, all right. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. It looks amazing today. Yes, come out on the 21st for our, go ahead, you can be seated. Come on out on the 21st for, or I don't know what you guys are doing up there. I knew you were doing something. Come on out on the 21st for an amazing a time of fellowship. And that evening, Darby Slayton will be in the house. And Darby is an amazing prophetic voice. He's now moved to Virginia, and he's coming back. So make that a night. Make it a family night. Come on out and have spaghetti and share and love and family. And then stay extra and hear Darby rock the house. So thank you, sweetie.
What up, Harvest Chapel? All right, hey guys, this is very important. I'm about to make a very important announcement. I need you all to listen. All right. After service today, out in the coat room, right out here, there will be truffles that were made by Mrs. Mariah Tyler that is in the back row in the swagging out hat. And, so we need you guys' help because the youth is throwing on a little prom, and all the money that you guys put towards Mrs. Mariah's famous, amazing truffles, like, I don't know if you guys ever had one, but, like, they have to be one of the best things I've ever eaten in my entire life, honestly. Like, I'm not kidding you. Also, so go grab a box. Go grab three boxes, and if you have diabetes, we'll pray for you, and then you can get a box anyway. Also, after offering, there will be youth for grades 7 to 12 up in the loft. And also, there will be youth from 1 to 5 today. And that is very fun. So parents, if you have kids and you can't pick them up anyway, because it's fun.
Yep, just buy the truffles and we'll pray for you. Hey, sounds good to me. They are very, very good. I had one that was my breakfast this morning. There was little bitty tasty samples out there, and the peanut butter ones, oh, very good. So thank you, thank you. And it's going to be a fun time for the kids and for the prom. If you are a first-time visitor in the house this morning, we want to welcome you. And these lovely people up here have some welcome packets to give you and put into your hands. So raise your hands high. We would like to give you a welcome packet. And then we'd like you to go out to the visitor station after service. We have a little gift for you. And thank you for being with us, first time in our house. Also wanted to say that if you have a Team Caleb shirt on today, it is free coffee for you today at the cafe. Thank you, Mr. Tom. And it is 10% off in the booking gift shop today if you have a Team Caleb shirt on. So make your way to the bookstore today as well after service. So thank you, thank you, thank you. We had an amazing, refreshing week out in beautiful Grand Canyon area. I heard last week Lisa rocked the house, as only Lisa can do. But it was a beautiful time over there, seeing the handiwork of God. Oh my gosh, the mountains, the hills. It is just, it's just beautiful. And yes, Phoenix was 105. I liked that. It was an amazing time. It's wonderful to be able to get together and be refreshed in the Word, in the beauty of His goodness, and come back and just share more of His love and getting ready to activate this coming summertime. Now is one of my favorite times. We get to sow, sow, sow. So let's all stand. We have our seed in our hand. If you're not familiar with Harvest Chapel, we like to bring our seed forward and love on each other and sow our seed to the Lord. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity that we got to come into your home today, that we got to be with our brothers and sisters, and we got to hear some amazing stories and testimonies of some goodness that you have done. Thank you that now I get the opportunity to plant this seed. I get to watch it grow. I get to see the glory. I get to know that it's helping locally here in our food banks and in our missions. I know that it's helping this ministry stay on. I know that it's going to nations and helping bless the children clear across. Thank you that my seed is partnering with what you are doing from heaven to earth. Father, thank you for this opportunity. I thank you for the abundance that you're blessing me and my family and this family and our online viewers. Thank you, Father, for this time, this day. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Daddy. We love you because God is good. Amen. Come sow your seed.
What kind of love is this that has overcome the world? What kind of love is this that can save us from ourselves? What kind of love is this that has overcome the world? What kind of love is this that can save us from ourselves? It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love. What kind of love is this that has overcome the world? What kind of love is this that can save us from ourselves? Say, what kind of love is this that has overcome the world? What kind of love is this that can save us from ourselves? It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love, yeah. It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love, yeah. It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love, yeah. It's an unfailing love, yeah. It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love. It's an unfailing love.
Last time.
What kind of love is this that has overcome the world? What kind of love is this that can save us from ourselves?
Bless you. Amen. Bless the Lord. Everybody good? Come on. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's an awesome day. We're living in an awesome time. It's exciting. I believe that you ought to feel more excited about today than you've ever been in your life. You're closer right now to seeing Jesus than you've ever been before. Oh, there's four of us that are happy. I'm excited for you four. Come on. Here's the reality, man. This is a great day. We're living in a really, really exciting time. And what I'm finding is, today we're going to launch a program called Activate Love, okay? And I'm pretty pumped about it. Nicole and I had talked about this a little while ago, and we kind of made some plans, and it snuck up on me faster than I thought it was going to, and it's already started. Today's June already. Like, that should be illegal to be that fast. It's just happening. But in the place, watch, because time's slipping, time's going quickly. And when I was a young boy, like 14, 15 years old, and I would listen to my parents talk about how when you get older, time goes quicker, I thought they were lying. I found out something. They were telling the truth. It just seems like it happens all so quick. Here's the reality. If I'm further ahead in my walk with God right now than I've ever been before, then I ought to be more excited about being on the earth right now than I've ever been before. Because I know him better and can manifest him in a greater measure. The question is, as a people, are we manifesting him more right now than we did a year ago? And I hope I make sense when I'm saying that. I want to say this. A lot of times we speak in a language that's probably actually foreign to true theology, because we say, Lord, I want more of you. How many know you got all of them you're going to get? You just want him to manifest more. But when he came, he didn't come in portions. I hope that makes sense. Does that make sense? Y'all follow what I'm saying? So when we say that, we're not really saying we want more, but we want him to manifest more. Does that make sense? I hope I'm making sense. Because when he came, he fully came. As a matter of fact, you know what's really cool? He didn't just say, I'm coming, I'm bringing my Father with you. Isn't that cool? He said, I'm bringing my Father with me. I and the Father will come and make our abode in you. That means Jesus lives fully in you. And the Father lives fully in you. And he said, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he shall be with you, for he'll be in you. That means the Holy Spirit's in you. Father's in you, Son's in you, Holy Spirit's in you, fully and completely. And when we begin to understand that, it's about manifesting him. Letting the world see the reality of Christ in you. Why? Because Paul said it's Christ in you that's the hope of glory. So we're about to start a campaign called Activate Love. What I want to ask you a question is, what does that look like in your life? What does God being manifested, what does love being activated inside of you, what does that look like in your life? And how does that change your perspective? I live from a theology that says this: I won't act differently if I don't think differently. And I won't think differently if I can't see differently. But if I see differently, I'll think differently. If I think differently, I'll act differently. So being able to see what that looks like in your life is my challenge for the next couple of months. I'm going to help us walk through some things. We're going to start with it today. We're going to look at a couple of different things. But one of the first places I want to go to, it's a text that's on the front of your bulletin this morning. It's 1 John chapter 3. And I want you to turn there if you would. And we're going to look at verse 18. I'm going to read it in the official King James Version. Okay. I want you to see something that I absolutely love. And here's where it starts out. Watch what he first says. He says, my little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Now, the reason I say that, and I wanted to read it from here, is this: because he starts out, my little children. How many understand? He's writing to Christians. He's not writing to the heathen. He's not writing to the unbeliever. He's not writing to the people that don't know God. He's writing to a people that would call them. Come on, we talk about being sons and daughters. What's he talking to? My little children. He's talking to Christians. Actually, if you read the context of the letter, he's probably writing to spiritual children that he saw birthed into the kingdom in his own ministry. So when I think about that, what he's saying, hey, you're sons and you're daughters, but listen to me. We're called to do something. He says, don't just talk the talk, walk the walk. Yeah. You know what he was saying? He was saying this love thing looks like something. It's got to look like something. It can't just be a matter of talk. It can't just be a matter of conversation. How many of you have ever been with somebody and you knew it wasn't going well, and then they said, well, I love you, brother. And your first thought was, liar, liar, pants on fire. Because you felt like, man, I don't feel no love here. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. You can say all kinds of things. You can skywrite, I love you, with an airplane. Doesn't mean you love somebody. That's not love. What's this thing really look like? We're going to talk about it a whole bunch, because I believe that there's things that we need to do. I'm going to talk to you real plain. It went really well in the first service. If it goes as well in this service, I'm going to be pretty excited. But listen to me. There's something about you and I understanding, my little children, let's not just love in word, neither in tongue, but let's do it in deed and in truth. It looks like something. Go to verse 14. Let's back up. I'm going to walk us through this. We're going to talk about some stuff. We know that we pass from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abides in death. Let's talk about that. We pass from death unto life. What's he say? You were dead in your trespasses and sins, but you became alive in Jesus Christ. And how is that obvious in your life? Because there's a love inside of you now that wasn't in you before you were born again. Like before you were born again, you didn't even care. Now all of a sudden there's something, there's compassion rising up inside of you. There's a love inside of you. There's something, you saw the person on the street who wasn't doing too well and you just blew them off, but now you can't even walk by them that your heart's not moved. You pass from death to life. Why? Because there's a love inside of you that wasn't there before. This is much better preaching than you realize. We pass from death unto life because we love the brethren. Now watch what it says, because it gets real strong. And I think it's powerful. If we don't love our brother, we're still dead. Everybody see that? It's exactly what he said. If we don't love our brother, you can tell everybody on the planet you're a Christian, you're born again, you can tell it. Because you know what? You can say anything. Talk's cheap. Love looks like something. Talk's cheap, but love looks like something. It was Leonard Ravenhill that said, "We profess so much, but we live so little." That's a strong word, isn't it? Come on. But there's a place where you and I, we have to walk this thing out. Love looks like something. So watch what he says. Whoso hates his brother is a murderer. That's pretty strong. He just put hate and murder in the same category. Why? Because it is. Everybody get it? It's strong. But watch what he says. He that hates his brother is a murderer. You know no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. What did he say? Here's how we know God loved us. He laid down his life. Why? Because love looks like something. And that's what he's saying. It looks like something. If we want to know, people say, "Well, I don't even know if God loves me." Let me tell you something. The measuring stick of God's love's planted 2,000 years ago. He screamed, "I love you." Why? Because love looks like something. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. He said, God manifested his love to us. We ought to manifest our love to one another. It looks like something. It has to look like something. What's this thing look like? He said, this is how we perceive the love of God. He gave his son. We also ought to love the brother. What's he saying? It ought to look like something. So love has to be activated. It has to be an action. Love's a verb. It's not just a noun. It's a verb. It has action. It's an action word. It looks like something. So I began to think through that. Now watch. I love this. Because there's so much, John just speaks so much about this. But whoso has this world's good and sees his brother has needs and then shuts up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwells the love of God in him? Amen. Wait a minute. You got a brother with a need and you just shut up your bowels of compassion like you don't even care about it. Can I tell you something? I'm going to talk to you real plain. I believe that for too long, the church has stuck its head in the sand. We tried to pretend it wasn't real. We tried to pretend it wasn't happening. I'm kind of excited about some things because you know what? I see the church actually gripping culture right now. I'm going to talk to you real plain. I don't know where I'm going to go with all this. I know where it went in the first service. But I actually believe that the greatest need we have, and I'll talk to you. Our country's about 250 years old, somewhere, give or take a few, whatever. But here's what happened. When this country was first founded, it was founded on all these Christian principles, and the church made an impact and a difference in the government. It wasn't the government making the impact in the church. It was the church. Can I tell you something? This country's problems isn't the government's fault. It's the church that stuck their head in the sand. And unless we do something different, we're going to allow the government to run over our culture rather than the culture of the church changing the government. Amen. And I'm not one of those radicals that are out there trying to make a big deal. I'm simply saying this. If we continue to stick our head in the sand and we don't activate what's inside of us, why would we expect anything to change? Amen. Right. Now I feel like preaching. But it's what he said. The church regulated the culture of this country a couple hundred years ago. Now the government's regulating it. And look where we've gone. And I'm not critical. I'm not trying to be ugly. I'm simply saying, man, we got to do something. We've seen the need. But if we just stick our head in the sand, nothing's going to change. Well, Pastor, who am I? I'm just one person. How can I make a difference? You can make a difference for one more person. And if you make a difference for just one person and everybody did that, we'd double in a week. Oh my goodness, that's pretty amazing. Maybe we could actually take the culture back. Oh, because the church is called to change culture. How do you know it? I read it in Acts 17. These that turned the world upside down have come hither also. Whoo! Come on, it was the church changing the culture. Why? Because they got active. Because they didn't bury their head in the sand. Now watch. I feel so radical right now. My little children, let us not love in word. Yeah. Eric's saying, yeah, I feel like I'm getting my long hair back. Come on. But there's something about making a difference. We're called to that. My little children, let's not just love in word, not just in tongue, but in deed and in truth. What if we actually started walking out what we really believe? What if we actually started making a difference? What if we actually started reaching out in love and compassion and just changing the culture one life at a time? Can I talk to the church and tell you some things? There's a place where we need to understand how, when I had my hair, we used to sing a song that said, they'll know we are Christians. How was it? Come on, you bunch of hippies, you knew those words. Okay, come on. Come on, we knew it, right? And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. How many know that's a straight quote from Jesus? It's John 13:35. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, because you have love one to another. How are they going to know it if we just got our head in the sand? They're only going to know it because it's active love. Because love's an action. It's not... Love looks like something. It's about you and I walking this thing out, walking in love, actually living this thing, walking it out day by day, and really, really becoming, it becomes the reality of our life. It's not just a big deal, it's the big deal. Go to James chapter 2. I got so much I want to share with you. Look at verse 14. What's it my profit? What doth it profit, my brethren? Though a man says he has faith, but he doesn't have works. Can faith save him? I thought we were saved by faith. Does it say that? Come on, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. We're saved by faith. By grace through faith, right? Not by works, right? So we got this not by works mentality in us. That said, oh, it's not about what I do. It's about what he did 2,000 years ago. How many know that's true? But it's not a response. It's not a place where we shirk the responsibility. Come on, I got saved. The salvation that comes inside of me, the salvation that radically transforms me, the salvation that changes my life, will cause me not to have to do works. I get to do works. Come on. We said, I'm not a servant, I'm a son. I preached that for a whole year, Galatians 4:4-7, right? And I preached it for a whole year. I'm not a servant, I'm a son. But guess what? I'm a son who gets to serve. It's my privilege to serve. I get to be a servant. So watch what he says. What's it profit, my brethren, though a man says he has faith, but he doesn't have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister's naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, notwithstanding you give him not those things which are needful to the body, what does it profit? Who understands what that just said? That just said, if Barb comes to me and she doesn't have any food, and she said, Pastor, we got no food in the cupboard, we got no food in the refrigerator, we got no food in the house, and I don't know what to do, and I'm sitting there with a refrigerator full of groceries and a freezer full of meat, and my cupboards are over full. And I'll say, oh, Barb, let me pray for you. Lord, bless her and help her. Amen. Go get them, honey. I'm praying for you. Come on. Come on. You guys know where I'm at. This is real. I'm just being down home right now. But come on. Because we're too easy and we feel spiritual because we prayed for them. Faith without works is dead, being alone. Watch what he says. Come on. Even so, if it hath not works, even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Everybody see it? Come on, why? Because it looks like something. Faith looks like something. Love looks like something. How are we going to deal with this? How's this going to change our lives? Because it has to get to a place where it becomes transformational. Watch what he says. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me your faith without your works. I'll show you my faith by my works. Do you understand what he just said? Come on. Can I talk? I'm going to talk to the church now. I'm going to put my Bible down. When I put my Bible down, it means I'm really going to preach. But listen, I'm going to talk to you because here's the reality. And I thank God for the church. Don't hear me wrong. But it's not about you wearing a God is good shirt to work on Tuesday, right? That's not going to explain your Christian walk. Here's the reality. It's the walk you're walking when you're just wearing a white T-shirt. There you go. Come on. It's the walk you're walking and you got your plaid flannel on. I don't care what it is you're wearing. Here's the reality. The truth of the matter is, it's not the t-shirt you wear or the Bible you carry. It's the life that you live that's going to make the difference. You're going to show me your faith. I'll show you my faith by my works, because it's the life I'm living that's going to make the difference. And if I'm not living the life, I ought to be careful about the title I'm carrying. Because if I'm going to take the title Christian, it literally translates Christ-like one. I know it's strong today, but I feel this really, really powerful. We're going to activate this thing. There's some things that are transpiring. I'm telling you, I feel this really strong in my heart. But it's about you and I living this thing, walking this thing, and being real about it. We're going to activate love. So James says this. He says, you say you got faith? I'll show you my faith by my works. You know what the next verse says? Read it. It says, you say you believe in God? Yeah, so does the devil. That's exactly what it says. The devils believe also and tremble. It's what it says. Come on. I believe in God. That doesn't mean a thing. Demons believe in God. That's the word devils there translates better. Demons, I'll leave that alone. But watch this. Here's the reality. What he's saying, listen, it's not about just what you believe. It's about what you're living. Because if we really believed it, we'd really live it. If I really believe what I say I believe, wouldn't I live? We say so much and live so little. That's a strong verse. It's burning in me right now. God, teach us to walk this thing out. So I'm reading this stuff and it speaks volumes to me right now. And I feel this really, really strong in my heart. So we got this thing in our hearts. What's it look like to activate this? Watch what he says. Look at verse 20. Wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Watch what he says. Wasn't Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son upon the altar? I want you to think with me for a minute. If you were to appear in the courtroom of heaven and stand on trial before the Lord, would your works back up your words? I believe. Would your works back up your words? That's strong, isn't it? There's an old phrase that said, if it was a crime to be a Christian, would your neighbors have enough evidence against you to convict you? Ooh. Come on. Would your neighbors have enough evidence against you to convict you and find you guilty? Let's walk. See how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. And the scripture was fulfilled and said, Abraham believed God. It was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he's called the friend of God. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? I love this stuff. Because it really makes me think. I want to walk this thing out. Isn't it amazing? By faith, Abraham offered Isaac upon the altar. Why? Because he believed that if he took his life, God was going to raise him from the dead. Because God said, out of his seed. Come on. Out of Isaac would all the earth be blessed. Something had to happen. That's why the back of your shirt says, when I don't understand, I still choose God. Why? How many things go on in your life you don't understand? Come on. If I said, everyone who understands everything perfectly, please stand. Look, I'm the only one standing. No, I'm just messing. I'm just messing. Here's the reality. There's so much that we don't understand. Yet there's a place where, by faith, we just keep walking this walk. Now watch what he says, because it gets really strong. Watch the next couple things that he says. Because in these next couple verses, we're challenged. You see then how by works a man is justified, not by faith only. Likewise, wasn't Rahab the harlot justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? That challenges me. Come on. Because we got her job description. Never mind. Right? Come on. Come on. But there's a place where she stepped into faith, and all of a sudden her and her household are delivered from destruction. What's he saying? It seems like there was grace even back when there was the law. I guess Jesus is Lord. Follow with me, man. As the body without the spirit is dead, faith without works is dead also. What's it saying? I believe this thing ought to look like something. Faith ought to look like something. Love ought to look like something. If we're going to activate this, what's it going to look like to activate it? I'm convinced that every one of us is called to walk out a love walk that'll impact our community. I want to challenge you. Some of you are familiar with a lady named Heidi Baker. A matter of fact, I think Kirsty starts tomorrow over there to school, at Heidi's school. And you know what she's famous for? Love the one in front of you. Now watch, her and her husband Roland transformed a nation. I don't know if you guys know this, but they literally have transformed a nation. The nation of Mozambique is not the same because they've lived there, because they've moved there. And they've literally transformed a nation. I mean, to the place where he's on the cover of magazines and different things because they've transformed a nation. You follow what I'm saying? How they do it? By loving the one in front of them. Now, you might not transform a nation, but let me tell you something. You can transform a neighborhood. You can transform the family reunion. Trust me, it's easier for the neighborhood. Never mind. Listen, that's true. It might be easier for a nation for some of you, but listen. But the reality is, that's that whole prophet without honor, right? Okay, you guys know where I'm at. But listen, the reality is that it comes from activating love in your own life. By this will all men know you're my disciples, how? Because you have love one to another. How's that going to happen? The world's going to have to see it. How would the world know that you have love one for another unless it's active and the world can actually see it? So a little while ago, Nicole had this thing burning inside of her heart. She began to share with me. Come on, honey. So there's something that I want to bring across to us this morning, and I'm just going to tag with her right now. Because she wants to walk us through what I believe is a God idea. Not just a good idea, but a God idea. Because there's a difference between good ideas and God ideas. So follow with her as she just begins to share her heart and brings this thing across, and I'll bring back and bring it to a close.
Wait a minute.
I am. Help us out, Corey.
Okay. Is that okay?
I got you.
Wait a minute. Am I your daughter?
You are.
Did I earn the right to be your daughter? Didn't I earned that, right?
No, you're just privileged.
Wait. Right? So, wait a minute. I have a serious question.
Sure.
You're very proud of me. I'm up here. You're proud of me, right?
I am proud
of you. You're pretty proud of me. I come to church. You're pretty proud of me. I live a good life. You're pretty proud of me.
Sure.
So I earned that, sort of, by doing the right things. Say yes.
Yes.
Yes. But.
Go ahead.
If that wasn't the case and I was somewhere and you didn't know where I was, would I be your daughter?
You'd still be my daughter.
Because you would love me.
I would still love
because
you.
Because I didn't earn it.
Even if you didn't earn it.
So I don't have to earn the right to be your daughter, but I can work to earn your pride.
Okay.
So that you would be proud of me. So in the same way, we don't have to earn our salvation. We couldn't earn it, right? We couldn't earn it, but we could work to make God proud of us. Don't you want to make God proud of you? I want to make God proud of me every day. You can sit down. I got this. Thank you very much.
I'll be right over here if you need
me. You can go ahead and sit down. That's all I needed. Thank you. And so in my quest to make God proud of me, I want to make God proud of me. And so like many of you, because I've talked to many of you, I sat down and I prayed, God, what do you want me to do with my life? What do you want me to do with my life? You're not answering me. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? What do you want from me? What's my destiny? What's my great plan? We quote the Jeremiah verse all the time that you have a hope and a plan and good plans for a great future, and that's all running out wrong. And we know it, though, because we all cling to it. We know that God has a great plan for our life. What is it? Why is it a mystery? Why do you elude me with this plan? And God said, turn in your Bible to Matthew 28, and he showed me something. And it was, I'll show you. In Matthew 21 and 18, so this is where, we're familiar with this. This is the week before Jesus would go to the cross, okay? And he is hungry, and he's on his way. And he comes across a fig tree, and he goes up to it, and he would like some figs, right? He's hungry, and there's no fruit on it. And so he cursed the fig tree and said, may no fruit ever come from you again. And the fig tree withered at once and died. Okay? And so I was like, so what does that mean? Right? And so I saw that he expected fruit from the tree. Okay? And when it didn't produce fruit, he was pretty upset with it. Jesus got upset. Let's just clear that up right now. I don't think he was like, well, then fine. I think he was pretty mad because in my Bible, there's an exclamation point. Now, I know we added that, but let's just be real. Jesus was a real person. He was probably irritated because men are irritated when they're hungry. It's all right. So, What's interesting to note is that this was actually not the season for the tree to bear fruit. Okay? There's no apples on the trees right now. This isn't their season. I know that we don't grow figs around here, but if we did, this would not be their season. And this was not the time that it was their season either. And yet Jesus still expected them to bear fruit, even though it wasn't their season. Because Jesus was on his way to his destiny. You know, when he was born, what was he born for? What was his purpose? What was the point of Jesus' birth? Simply to die. That was the only purpose. That was the point. Jesus was born to die. That was his royal destiny. But on the way to that, luckily for us, he showed a lot of fruit. Okay? He was judged by his fruit. That's how they knew he was the Son of God. Not just because he was born to a virgin, but because he acted it out throughout his life. He bore fruit on the way to his destiny. And then Jesus said, that's what I expect from you. I expect you to bear some fruit also on the way to your destiny. So I'm going to use a great example. I love the Joyce Myers. You guys love the Joyce Myers? She's a great lady. And so on her way to becoming to where the level that she has achieved of reaching millions of people on a regular basis, prior to that, she taught Bible studies of 10. Okay? Prior to that, she didn't just wake up one day and God was like, I have this place for you. Poof! You are going to be in front of lots of cameras. She worked her way up for it. You know how she got there? By bearing fruit throughout the journey. And so God requires the same thing of us to continually bear fruit. And so I looked a little deeper and I thought, oh, you know where it was? It was in Antioch, where they were first called Christians. You know, when Jesus died and resurrected and then they started the church, they were called believers because they believed in Christ, because it was a new idea and they believed in him. But once they got to Antioch, that changed. Something happened and that changed, because instead of just being believers in Christ, they were now called Christians, which means Christ-like. So it was no longer the fact of what they just believed, but who they acted like that represented their name. They weren't just believers in Christ, but they were acting like Christ, and therefore they earned the word Christian. And now for years, we have kind of stepped back. I've watched it happen. I've been guilty of it myself, where we stopped using the word Christian as much. We started saying we're believers, because some people had dirtied the word Christian for me. Because that's still happening, because the world got confused, because some of parts of the church got confused about what Christ looks like, and they misrepresented my Jesus, and so we tried to change our word usage, and I want to take that word back. I want to say, if you are a Christian, then you act like Christ. I'm not ashamed of that word, and I don't need to change it. I need to correct the people who are using it wrong. So Jesus said that you would know. Jesus said, because it's in red. Red is so good. It's so extra good. Like, the whole book is good, but the red stuff is the extra good stuff. So in Matthew 7, he told us, you can identify people by their fruit, by the way that they act. A good tree produces good fruit, and a bad tree produces bad fruit. And I'm telling you, for the last several months, we've been talking about our identity and knowing who we are, and we are the children of God. And that means something. And then we just recently had our conference, which was Arise, and we were told to get up like a child when you're trying to teach them to stand. We're telling, God's saying, get up. And now he's saying, go forward, activate that. So come November, the love of God is shining out of us so brightly, it can't be mistaken. It's time to arise and activate. And so we want to activate love. So I said, what does that look like? What about me, God? What do you want me to do? Right? Because that's what we do when we don't hear from God. We whine. We think it's more effective. My 8-year-old does the same thing. It's not effective. And God said, well, if it's not effective for her, probably I'm a better parent than you are, right? I mean, God, I'm saying God's saying, I'm probably a better parent. You should follow my example. So whining is not effective. I'm just going to put that out there now. Please remember that. In any case, it was a really good quote, totally given to me by God. And he said, do you want more from God or do you want to do more for God? Because those are just a few words changing it around, but boy, does it change the meaning and your purpose and what you're looking to do. And so I continued to pray, and my prayer changed. My words, my powerful, powerful words that God gives us that can make fig trees wither and mountains move into the sea, our powerful words, I shifted and said, God, what do you want me to do instead of what do you want for me? What? It's not about me. What do you want me to do for you? Give me a vision for this house. Give me a vision for what you're doing here. Show me how I can help. Show me how I can be a part. Show me your plan. Show me what you have. And so, like a very good father, he answered me when I asked the right way. Okay? Kylie came to me this morning. She was asking me for money. She asked Nana too. She's very good at asking for money. She'll probably come up and ask you guys at some point. I had to teach my Caleb, who's now 12, for years, I had to teach him, stop asking the church people for money. Because he would just go around and give it to them. He would just be, can I have a dollar? And people would give him a dollar everywhere. And I was like, stop giving him a dollar. Stop. But he asked for it, and people were like, oh, isn't he cute? And they gave him a dollar, and I was so mortified. But he got the dollar. Kylie's not as good at getting the money because she's not as good at asking for it. Caleb was good at asking for it. People wanted to. He could talk you into it. He could sell ice to Eskimos. He actually could. We're going to put him in charge of our fundraising campaigns in the future. But Kylie's not good. She just comes up and she's like, can I have $9? For what? Why? Why would I ever give you $9? Have you earned? No, go away. I'm very irritated. But once she changes it and tells me she wants a book from the bookstore here at church, and it's this book about pigs, and I got building their house on the sand and the rock, and I was like, oh, well, you want a book from the Christian bookstore? Well, then yes, I'm probably gonna give her the money. But because she didn't ask for it the right way, she didn't get it the right way, okay? It's gonna take her more time to achieve that goal. And so this is the same idea. Once you ask God for the right thing the right way, he wants to give it to you. So he answered me. And so in his answer, he gave me a vision. He said that we have been in the springtime and we have been learning to arise, but now summer is here and the fruit is bearing a harvest. And it is time for us to be that fruit and to be a harvest, okay? Guys, I'm verbal affirmation. Come on. Oh, yeah. There we go. Come on. Verbal affirmation is my love language. Help me out. And so, we're going to kick off our Activate Love campaign, and I am going to explain to you what that means. First of all, I believe that God never does anything for one purpose, but always has many purposes. So that's important to understand. So we looked at this, and I looked at 7 folds of activating love. And so I'm going to break it down. We have love is generous. Love is kind. Love connects. Love celebrates. Love lends a hand. Love commits. And love makes a difference. Now, if you have your pens and paper today, you're going to want to write some of this stuff down. This is really good. I'm just letting you know. All right. So we're going to start out with generous love. We're breaking this down to the 7 folds of what we're going to be activating. And every week you're going to start to see more things. I know you saw the amazing tree that was kind of unique, painted out. I don't know what to call this. In the lobby, in the middle part, you saw a very cool tree. And Miss Mariah painted that for me on a dime. I asked her on Wednesday, can you paint me a tree real quick? And she did it in like less than an hour. She's a pretty amazing person. And so that was her activating her love by using her talents to help me out. And so with generous love, we are going to get involved in our community. And I'm going to give you the opportunity to pour into different, I don't want to say different ministries, different blessings. So this, the next 3 weeks, we are going to be collecting individually wrapped snacks, like that you would put in a child's lunch, like crackers, like Oreos, like chips. There are some examples out there on the table, but things that you would pack in a lunch. We're going to collect as many as we can over the next 3 weeks, and we are going to be giving those to our local heroes. And our local heroes meaning our firemen, our policemen, and our EMTs. We also have cards. You can get your own card and bring it in, or you can buy one of our blank cards for a dollar, and you just can write a note of appreciation or thanks. And then at the end of 3 weeks, we're gonna take these and deliver them to as much stuff as we collect. That's how many we're gonna be able to bless, okay? So we're gonna start with Abbottstown, then go to New Oxford, then go towards Hanover, and just try to bless the heroes around us. And just saying thanks, we appreciate you. And it's just one more way for us to extend love and show that we're actually doing what we're supposed to be doing as Christians, right? And just saying we love you and we appreciate what you're doing and we're honored that you're willing to serve our community. So over the next 3 weeks, please bring in some individual snacks and some cards just to thank our local heroes. Now, my favorite part of this is over the entire summer, every week when you come in, we're going to talk about love is kind. Because if you read in Corinthians, we know, people use it in weddings. It's very popular. Love is patient. Love is kind. And so every week, what I want from this house, what I'm begging you to do, is every week in your bulletin, right there in the middle, is going to be three intentional acts of kindness. And these are intentional. They may be spontaneous, but they are not random. Atheists are random. Christians are intentional. So we need to be intentional about being kind to the people around us. And right here in the middle, we'll have three different suggested acts of kindness. I would like you to commit to doing at least one of these acts of kindness every week. So this week, maybe you'll send a gift to a teacher. Maybe you'll invite some neighbors or friends over for a barbecue to your house. Because hosting people at your house is something I think Jesus really, really likes. Especially when there's food involved. And a really neat idea is to pay for, when you go through maybe the fast food place or the Starbucks drive-thru or something like that, I want you to ask to pay for the person behind you in line and just let them know what you're doing. This has happened before. They've done this where somebody at Starbucks, it was actually a Starbucks, and they paid for somebody behind them just to be a blessing. And then when the person who was next got up and the cashier said, well, somebody already paid for you. And they just said, have a blessed day. And they were like, that's awesome. And so then they paid for the person behind them. They paid it backwards. We always talk about pay it forward, but they were kind of paying for the person behind them. So they paid it backwards. And that actually went on for hours. It was like a chain reaction of just blessing people because you know what? People want to be a blessing. Do you want to be a blessing? Because we're looking for ways to be a blessing. So we're going to give you a lot of avenues this summer. So every week we're going to have three different acts of kindness. Pick at least one of them, and it will change every week. I want to see those things coming out of this house. It's very intentional and specific. I hope you're doing even more acts of kindness than that, but I am asking you to make that commitment because love commits. And so you will also see in your bulletin the love commits little tear-off side. You can tear this off. Because love commits, and that's the most important part of love, and if love understood the commitment, we'd see less and less divorce because love commits. So I want you to make a commitment that you will participate in one of these things that we have outlined for you, or you can add your own, and just fill out the paper. You can drop it in the box on your way out. I'm just looking for a commitment from the house to this ministry. I'm looking for a commitment to this vision. I'm looking for commitment to what God is doing here and to activating your love. I want you to be intentional about it. I want you to think it through. I want you to really make that commitment that you are going to partner with what heaven is doing right here at Harvest Chapel, right here in this community. And really be intentional and conscious about what you are committing to do and to be a part of. We also have Love Connects. We're going to have some different activities where people can get involved. We are going to do another Name Tag Sunday in a couple weeks because we want everyone to connect. Who likes the Name Tag Sunday? Woo! Oh, come on, people. Who likes the name tag Sunday? I want to know your name. I'm so mortified when I run into you at the Walmart and I don't know your name, or when you don't know my name. Right, Sally? When you don't, you know, it's hard when people think you should know their name and then you don't. We want to get to know each other because love connects. Everyone say love connects. We're going to make a love connection right here at Harvest Chapel. It's going to be great. And you know what else love does that it doesn't do enough? And I've noticed this morning we haven't done quite enough. Love celebrates. So we're going to take a minute. Let me hear love celebrate. Woo! All right, love needs to celebrate more. And so we are going to do some really cool events to celebrate. We're thinking like an outdoor worship concert, and that would be really fun right here on the grounds. That would just be an awesome time for people to come together and hang out. I'm super pumped about it. I know Jason's going to be pumped about it as soon as I tell him. In any case, we also have Love Lends a Hand. This is the most important aspect of where you can really... Love lends a hand. Do you believe that love lends a hand? Do you believe that it is important to be a part of what we're doing right here at Harvest Chapel? Do you believe that we will impact the world? Do you want to? Then Love Lends a Hand. And Love Lends a Hand is giving you the... This is not about we need more people to help us. We don't have enough. We don't have enough help to run things. It's not about that. It's about giving you the opportunity to be blessed by serving this house and this ministry. You know, I know Josh is, I'm going to use Josh B here for an example. He is always looking for cameramen, which is a very simple job. You just have to stay awake and point, right, Josh? Not a hard, you don't even have to miss service. You actually have to pay extra attention to it. So it's a really great opportunity. And do you know that in the course of the year, I wish I had the number exactly, but do you know that our online ministry reaches over 100,000 people a year? I know it's a lot more than that, actually. I know I'm not, it's a lot more than that, but it's over 100,000 people we reach a year. And do you know that that's not possible except for the volunteers that work with Josh B? That's pretty good. We need some people to lend a hand and actually impact the world. It might seem like a small part, but it's making a big difference. You know, we reach people in just about every country in this world. What are we're like missing like five countries. We're in like every country. We're all over the place because people like our word, because we've got a good word going out, and we can't do that without people to help with tech and help people to help with the cameras. You know, we need help in a children's ministry because we got a lot of children. And they're awesome, and they're so excited to learn, and they're just so great. And so we have different things where we have opportunities for you to be a blessing, opportunities for you to get involved. And I'm telling you, when you start to actually activate and walk in it, it's more of a blessing to you. Like, when I do something for somebody, like, let's say, you know, when I go take this stuff to the firemen and they're happy about it and they're touched, that's going to bless me more. That's going to be more of a blessing to me, seeing the reaction, seeing the seed being sown, seeing the, you know, the people that you're blessing. It's more valuable to me than all the money and all the time and everything else, because actually being the hands and feet of Jesus, there's just nothing. I can't explain it to you because there are no words. Try it out for yourself. You're just going to have to trust me. So we have lots of areas where we're giving you the opportunity to actually be hands and feet and show love and be activated in that. We also have Love Makes a Difference, which we're gonna feature some of the different ministries that we partner with. You know, you pay in your tithe to Harvest. Harvest pays their tithe out. We pay our tithe out to different charities throughout the community, throughout the world. And we wanna let you know more about those and how you could possibly get involved with some of these other ministries as well, because we're making an impact in the world, and we know you want to make an impact in the world. And just let you know what kind of ministries that we do connect with. So those are the seven folds of how we're going to activate love. I'm really, really excited about what God's doing here. I'm excited that he's raising us up and having a higher expectation. And I am really excited to see love coming out of here. And one of the most important things that I want back from you guys is I would like some testimonies. I would like you to share your stories of how this is impacting you, of when you do share love, when you do have acts of kindness and things, you know, the story that happens of that. This is a silly one. I went around the other day. I took three carts from three different people because on my way back with my cart to the Walmart, there was a couple other people who needed, you know, who just finished unloading their carts, and one was an older woman and one was a lady who had two kids with her, and I thought, that's a hassle. So I just grabbed up the carts and I took them in, and the one woman, I thought she was gonna cry, you know? She was just like, why are you taking my cart? I was like, I'll take it back for you. And she's like, hey, that was the mom with the two kids, and if you are a mom and you've been at Walmart with two kids, you totally understand that you're like, thank you, I can't move anymore. So, you know, it's just like little things that you can do to really bless people, and it was just, I was just glad to be a blessing, and so I want to hear your stories with that as well. Please connect with us on Facebook, because we're going to have a lot of information out there, and we want to make a difference and an impact in a social world as well as in a physical world. And it's a whole other world, and it's very real and very important as well. So please connect with us that way too. Share your stories on our Facebook wall. And here at the office, you can give us a call and share your stories, because really testimony is making it come alive. And that's glorifying God in the best way. Who wants to glorify the Lord? Who's ready to be loved? I'm done. You can come back now. You get to come back. Would you like to tell them more about activating love?
I can. Thanks, honey. You can take that with you. Amen. I have my own. Okay. Everybody good? You understand what she was saying? And I love what she's sharing. Now listen. Go to John 15. I'm going to close this thing up. Okay? But there's something that's very special right now. And I want to challenge you with this, because we're kind of challenged with this word. What's it look like for me to activate this thing in my life? I believe that we have one of the most loving churches on the planet. I get this comment all the time. People come here and they'll tell me this. They'll tell me, you know what? I feel more love in 3 weeks here than I did for years anywhere else. You know, and I've had that happen a lot of times. People told me, I got hugged more here in one day than I did in 2 years. And it's kind of neat. It's a loving house, and I thank God for that. The idea is that our love has to go beyond the doors. Everybody okay with that? And that's what she's trying to say. It has to go beyond the doors. It has to be active. It has to be real. So I think about this, and I think, man, how is this going to make an impact? Over and over, these kind of stories happen. Let me share this. Ryan, our youth pastor, Ryan, he's with some friends, and he's in Gettysburg, and he goes to a restaurant in Gettysburg. And while he's there, he's moved in his heart to there's an older couple there, and he wants to get their check because the Lord thumped his heart. What? It's not a random act of kindness. It's an intentional act of kindness. Who understands what she was saying? Because I preached that really hard over in the other room. It's intentional. It's being intentional. God is speaking to me more and more about being intentional about what's going on. So he goes up and he says, listen, give me their check. I want to cover their bill. I want to cover their dinner. So he ends up paying for their dinner. It's a long story. I could get into the whole thing. I don't have time for it. But the fact of the matter is, the owner of the restaurant came to him and said, listen, man, what are you doing? And he said, I'm going to pay for their check. The Lord put it on my heart. He said, that's so cool. He said, yeah. He said, the Lord just put on my heart, I want to cover this. And he said, well, no, what's really cool is a couple of days ago, there were some other people in here, and they did the exact same thing. They covered somebody's dinner. And he said, well, how did that happen? I dropped my mic. I got it. How did that happen? And when he said, what happened was, he asked the people who covered the first dinner, why did you do this? I said, well, you know, we just feel like this is what the Lord would have us to do. And he said, are you Christians? They said, yeah. He said, where do you go to church? They said, they went to some little church in Abbottstown. He said, I can't remember the name of it, but do you know where Abbottstown is? And Ryan says, yeah, I got a pretty good idea. What are you saying? Intentional acts of kindness. Who knows what I'm talking about? Intentional, being intentional. We were gone in Sedona, Arizona last week, and while we were there, the year before we had gone, and we went to a restaurant called the Barking Frog. Now, that should be the wrong name for a restaurant, no matter who. But the food's really good. So we go to the Barking Frog, and we went there last year. We got a chance to bless a waitress, right? And it was her last day being there. She was actually leaving to go on the mission, to go into a mission school for 4 months. She was going to a school for missions for 4 months. We were very excited for her. So not only did we blessed her financially really good, but we got a chance to pray for her. She's bawling and crying. Lori took a princess necklace off, put it on her, and it really just moved her heart. Her name was Ashley. So when we went back this year, we started to ask her, said, hey, is she still here? You know what I mean? And she was, but she wasn't there when we were there. She was working lunch. We were there for dinner. So we didn't get a chance to see her. But you know what happened? One of the managers came over, and we started talking, just asking about that. And we didn't even get into the story. And they said, were you here on her last day last year? Watch. It's a town of 20,000 people. But at any given time, there's about 40,000 to 50,000 people because of the tourists that go through Sedona. A year goes by and they still remember that. I don't know if that means anything to you. But it comes through intentional acts of kindness. Intentionally loving people. Loving people on purpose. John chapter 15, let's go. Go to verse 1. I love verse 1. You know why I love verse 1? Watch what he says in verse 1. He says, I'm the true vine, and my Father's the husbandman. You know what I have underlined in several of my Bibles? The word true. Why? Because if he said, I'm the true vine, then there must be some false ones out there. He'd have never said, I'm the true vine, unless there were other vines that weren't true. Who understands that? I'm the true vine. Right? And my Father's the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that it might bring forth more fruit. Now you're clean through the word which I've spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch can't bear fruit of itself except that abide in the vine, no more can you except you abide in me. Now watch. I'm the vine, you're the branches. He that abides in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. I want to talk to you very quickly, if I can, and tell you that Jesus just spoke of four different kinds of people. Those that bear no fruit, those that bear some fruit, those that bear more fruit, and those that bear much fruit. I don't know if you got all that or not, but that's pretty deep. Do you understand what I'm saying? Come on, what's the fruit of your life? What's it look like? What's the fruit of your life looking like? Because if we're going to be intentional about loving, if we're going to be intentional about showing Jesus to the world, if we're going to be intentional about representing God in an amazing way, then you know what? We're going to have to be fruit bearers. He's calling us, man. Abide in me, and you'll bring forth more fruit. Abide in me, you'll bring forth much fruit. It's so powerful. Verse 16, you haven't chosen me, but I've chosen you. You haven't chosen me, but I've chosen you, and I've ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and your fruit would remain. What's the fruit of your life look like? What's the legacy of your walk look like? How many understand? You're creating a legacy. You're creating a legacy. It's incredibly powerful. Do you understand that the world around you is watching you? You're creating a legacy. That you should go and bring forth fruit and your fruit would remain. What's that going to look like? What's the fruit of your life? Every time I do a funeral, I often wonder this. Do you guys do this? I wonder what people say when I'm dead. Do you do that? Like, who will talk at your funeral? What will they say? I don't do a funeral anymore. They don't talk about this, but I'm driving down the Pennsylvania Turnpike, and I saw a bumper sticker that just totally rocked my world. It said, live such a life, the preacher won't have to lie at your funeral. I think it's a great bumper sticker. Come on. Yeah, that's powerful. There's a message there. Come on. What's the fruit of your life looking like? Can I tell you something I think is really, really strong? Live such a life, you don't have to wait till you're dead for somebody to say something nice about you. God, it'd be nice to hear it while you're living. Let's walk this thing, man. How's that happen? Get intentional. The Lord is speaking to me more and more about intentionally living. Living intentionally. Living on purpose. Intentionally sowing into the people around you. Intentionally loving your neighbors. Intentionally making an impact in the restaurant or the rudders or wherever you might be. Being intentional about the life you live and the walk you're walking. Being intentional about blessing people. I'm going to give you this because I'm pretty excited about this. We went to leave yesterday afternoon from Arizona. So normally, Pastor Lori, she's pretty efficient. She'll go online and she gets all of our passes and all that stuff so we can go through Express and whatever. And we didn't actually get our tickets, so we had to go through the thing. And here's what happened. We jumped off because we were flying United, but United got bought out, or bought out US Air. So we got off the United thing. We went up to the counter, and they didn't have our flight. We had to go to US Air. But in Phoenix, that's in two completely different terminals, and they're about three bus rides away. Y'all follow what I'm saying? So we got on a bus, we take off and we go down. So we got to go from Terminal 2 to Terminal 4 backwards. I can't remember. It doesn't even matter. When we get there, then there's a line, and you got to go through the line, and you finally get up to the desk, and then you got to, and they got 700 people trying to check in and two old ladies checking them in. Y'all follow what I'm saying? Who's been there? You know, and you're like, well, you're, and the planes are coming and going, you know what I mean? And then the thing pushes and you push these buttons and then it spits your tickets out, okay? You know what I mean? You get your boarding passes, right? So we're getting our boarding passes and I'm looking and I'm in seat, aisle number 3, seat letter F. And I thought for a minute, it's a jumbo plane. And I'm in aisle number 3. And I thought, wait a minute, that ought to be first class. But these were free tickets. We didn't even pay for these tickets. And we surely didn't get for. So watch, here's what happened. I asked her, I said, are these first class? She said, no. And I looked and I'm thinking, yeah, I think it is. So while she was doing some other things, I went over and talked to one of the ladies named Rosie, the volunteer. And I said, Rosie, let me ask you something. Is that a first class seat? And she looked at it. She said, that, sir, is first class. I said, yes, it is. It is now. So I got laughing. It was kind of funny. And so we get on the plane, and it was amazing to me. Now watch. I'm praying about this, because if we had just got right in and did all the things we thought we were going to do, we might not have got those seats. I don't know what happened. If they overbooked, they oversold, they had to move us up. Anyway, I'm sitting there on the plane. We're flying home. And I said, Lord, this is kind of amazing, because it's roomy there. And you might have noticed I'm a little large sometimes. Hard to notice on the camera, okay? but here's the reality. It was kind of nice. And there's this lady named Karen, and she is falling over herself trying to be nice. She's the stewardess in first class, right? And they'll just take care of you, and it's really, really nice. And so what happened was I was just kind of praying. I said, Lord, this is amazing. I kind of like this. And the Lord said this to me. He said, it's a prophetic act. I said, okay, what do you mean? He said, it's time for an upgrade. So I took that. I said, man, I like that. It's time for an upgrade. We got upgraded to first class. He said, it's a prophetic act. It's time for an upgrade. So I'm expecting a lot of upgrades in my life right now. I'm pretty excited. So watch. In the midst of that, I thought, I'm watching this Karen girl. And I said, Lord, she's been absolutely amazing. What would you want to say to her? Why? Because I believe that for us to be intentional, we've got to be aware of what God's doing around us. So come on. So watch. If God's moving in an airplane, how many know if you're 36,000 feet in the sky, you're closer to God anyway? Never mind. Okay. So here's my thought. I thought, listen, man, we're this close anyhow. Let's talk. What do you want to do in this plane? What are you doing? So I said, Lord, what do you got for Karen? And the Lord gave me a word for her. So I'm trying to figure out, how do you share this with her? Because now we're at the end of the flight. And so I got her off to the side and I just said to her, and I began to share with her some things that she'd been asking. She had been randomly asking God for something very special into her heart, but she hadn't really petitioned heaven all that much. But the Lord was giving her a yes, and she was getting a resounding yes from the Lord. And she got kind of excited. She said, really? And I said, yeah, that's what I'm hearing. I said, and I hear something else, that there's someone who's coming into your life in the very near future who will radically change your life before the end of the year. And she got, I'm gonna have a grandbaby. And she got all excited. Her daughter's pregnant. Somebody that's gonna come into her life and radically change. And it was about a love thing. And so what I found was that she got all excited about that. And you know what I was doing? Was sharing what God was speaking in the room. Why? I wanted to be intentional about blessing her. How many understand? When you live to be intentional, you can be a blessing to all kinds of people. But we have to get to a place where we want to be aware of what God's doing in the room. God, what are you doing in the room? God, what are you doing in the store? God, what are you doing in the Rutgers? God, what are you doing in the Walmart? Being aware of his presence, being aware of his spirit, being sensitive to what God's wanting to speak, say, and do. Why? Because the person that's beside you that looks absolutely fine, like they're on top of the world, might be being crushed by all the weight of it today. Who understands what I'm saying? Let's get intentional. We've got to be intentional. Come on, it's not random acts of kindness. It's intentional acts of kindness. Can I say this? Be intentionally awesome. You're allowed. I give you permission. Be intentionally awesome. You can't help but be awesome. You have an awesome God that lives inside of you. So you get to go out there and be awesome, and it's not your fault. Yay, God. Because there's an awesome God inside of you, and he's busting to get out. You have to do it on purpose. Love people on purpose. Do you know when they asked Jesus what was the greatest commandment, you know what he said? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. But he didn't stop there. And they only asked him for one. He gave him two. He said, in the second, it's just like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. You know what he just said? He said, love God, love your neighbor, and love you. You have to love yourself. If you can't love yourself, you're in trouble. Because that's one of the things God told you you had to do. That's a big deal. I'll help you with that. Jesus lives inside of you. And you love Jesus. You wouldn't be here if you didn't love Jesus. And since he lives inside of you, there's a part of you that you already love. And he'll teach you how to love the rest of you. Love your neighbor, love yourself. Listen to me. He says something real powerful. On all this hangs the law and the prophets. Everything that the law and the prophets were speaking about pointed to this concept that we would love God and love people. I don't think you have a problem loving God. Teach us now how to love people. Here's the challenge. This is what's really big in my heart right now. Intentional. Being intentional about loving people. It's incredibly easy to love someone who's been abused. Can you love the abuser? Teach us to love the abuser. It's easy to love the abused. Can you love the abuser? See, I found out a long time ago you don't get to pick and choose who you get to love. And I want to. I'd much rather just pick myself. I want to get to pick who I get to love. But you don't get to pick and choose who you get to love. As a matter of fact, a couple of years ago, I was challenged with some things, and here's what, and I asked the Lord, I said, because there was a certain person that just seemed to be rather hard to get along with, and I'm like, Lord, this is a challenge to me. And the Lord said, you don't have to love everybody. I said, oh, cool. He said, you only have to love the people I love. So as soon as you find somebody God doesn't love, you don't have to love them either. But I read this book that said, for God so loved the world. Come on, who's with me? There's a place where you and I are called to walk this thing out. Let's be intentional about it. Activate love. Nicole's given us what I believe is a God idea. A whole lot of places to reach out, touch people, partner with the ministry, see what God's doing. How can we be a part of what God's doing? How can we be a part of something bigger than ourselves? God's teaching us to walk this thing out. We're going to walk in love. Stand with me all over the place. I know right where we're going. I believe with all my heart that over these next 3 months, we're going to have an increased capacity to love people. I believe God will give us an increased capacity to love people. Over the next couple months, we'll talk about this. We'll not just talk about loving God. We'll talk about loving our neighbor. We'll talk about loving ourselves. We'll talk about loving our family. It has to begin at home. I believe with everything inside of me, if I went out and loved all kind of people out here, but I didn't have that in my house, I failed. Because it has to be real here and stretched to there. I believe that God challenges us to love one another. I'll tell you this right now, I'm going to prepare you, that if you step into this challenge with me for the next 3 months about loving people, I promise you there will be some very hard to get along with people come into your path. And you'll think the devil sent them, and I think it'll be God. Why? Because you won't learn how to love people by being around a bunch of lovelies. You learn how to love people by being around some grouches. Your neighbor will get all grouchy on you, and God will say, what are you going to do with that? Can you love that one? Come on. Your mother-in-law will move in. No, never mind. I'm just kidding. Okay. I had the best mother-in-law on the planet. I can say that. Here's the reality. God's teaching us how to love. Some of you went, no, Lord, not my mother-in-law. I heard that in my spirit. Come on. Stop it. Okay. I believe with everything in me that God's challenging our hearts right now. What can we do? And here's what I want to go with. What can we do this week to make an impact
in our neighborhood? What can we do this week to make an impact in our community? What can we do this week? Watch, from this Sunday till next Sunday, as we accept the challenge right in the middle of our bulletin. How do we pay it backward? What's the word? How can we touch somebody's life? What can we do to make an impact? What can we do to make a difference? It might be that the Holy Spirit just put somebody right now on your heart that you just know this week I've got to touch them. I've got to touch them in a loving way. I'm going to challenge you with this. If you ask God that you want to be a part of what God's doing in that, He will not give you something that's easy. If it's easy, it's probably just you, not God. If it's terrifying, it's probably Him. That's true. If it's terrifying, if it's just like, oh, that was probably God. And you were just rebuking it. But you ask Holy Spirit, God's going to give you somebody to love. God's going to give you somebody to touch. God's going to give you, He's going to lay somebody on your heart that you're going to make an impact and a difference, that you can intentionally love. Love intentionally. I want you to hear me that love's intentional. We've got to be intentional. God's really speaking to my heart a lot about intentionality, about intentionally loving people, about intentionally making a difference, about not being afraid to take that step, because you know what? God will back you if you're willing to do it. I'm telling you, it's a good season right now to believe God. So here's what I want to do. I want you to bow your head and close your eyes for just a minute. This is what I want to ask you. I want to let the Holy Spirit speak to you. But if you're in the house with me and you're saying, you know what, Lord? This is a summer for me to activate my love. I'm going to use the phrase, it's a summer to get my love on. I'm going to love. I'm going to love deeper. I'm going to love stronger. I'm going to love wider. Danny Silk wrote a book called Getting Your Love On. It's about loving people. And I would challenge you, man. Is there a place where you're saying, God, I want to love deeper. I want to love stronger. June, July, and August. By September 1st, I want to have more love in me than I've ever had before. God, I want something to transform me. I want something to change in my life. I want to love people. I want to touch people. I want people to see the love of God. I want people to see what Jesus really looks like. I took the title Christian. I want to show the world this is what Christ looks like. I want to represent Him well. I want His love to flow through me, touch the world that's around me. If you're with me this morning and it's a heart cry for you, I want you just to lift your hands right where you're at. I want to pray for you right now. Don't lift your hands if you don't mean it, but if you mean it and you lift your hands, God's going to see that. He's going to challenge you. You're going to have opportunities to love people. Opportunities to love people can sometimes be incredibly challenging, but I believe God will do that in us. He'll increase His love in us. Father, in Jesus' name right now, we receive the challenge. We accept the challenge by faith. We accept, Lord, this opportunity we have to love people. Teach us to love deeper and stronger. Let Your love be perfected in us, God. Perfect love in our hearts. Perfect love in our lives. Teach us, God, I pray. Let us learn to love deeper and stronger and wider than we ever have before. Let us make an impact and a difference, that we would impact our communities, that we would impact our houses, that we would impact our reunions, that we would impact our workplaces, that we would impact, God, our community around us, God, that we would impact our community so we could impact our county, so we could impact our state, so we could impact the nation, that we would take back the nation and change the culture. God, I see the early church had a love culture, and in that culture, God, they impacted the world around them. Teach us how to impact the world around us and change the culture where we exist, that it becomes a culture of love and a culture of grace and a culture of mercy, because we are in it. God, teach us how to walk this thing out. Father us in this hour that we might be the people You've called us to be. God, I thank You. God, I thank You, and I bless what You're doing right now. Let Your people rejoice in You, God. Let Your children rejoice in You, God. To the place, Lord, where love flows through us and the world around us is jealous for what we carry. God, that they become hungry for what we have and they become jealous for more of who we are. God, I'm asking, cause it to rise up strong in us and make such an impact that the world around us is transformed. Holy Spirit, I welcome You right now. And I'm asking You, God, just come in an amazing fashion in Jesus' name. Let me see a microphone. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Can somebody give the Lord a praise? Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a good word. Hang tight with me just a second. You still got that in your heart? Just hang with me just 1 second. We're going to do this and we're going to sing and then we're going to close.
But when I... When I came this morning, everything that was being said was done already. God gave me a vision of what he wanted to do in his people. And what he said is everybody's been real vertical. I always pray for the Church of America. And, oh, Nicole, you are right on, honey. Right on with what you're saying. And what God wants to do here this morning is he wants us to know that the glory is in us. It's already in us. And when we come, don't look for the leadership to create the miraculous. He wants you to give what's already in you. And what he wants to do here this morning is, the last prayer Jesus prayed was, he said, I want them to be one the way you, Daddy, and I are one. And there is where the supernatural is going to activate across the globe. When God's people can join together in the love of God and in the giving of his supernatural power, I just want for everybody this morning to join hands and lift your hands and say, Holy Spirit, have your way. The supernatural is in me. It's 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 in me. Do it, Jesus. Do it, Holy Spirit. Do it.
Amen. Amen. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Thanks, buddy. How many believe it's really in you? It's, you got to know it's in me. It's in me. It's in me. I think it's so cool because how many remember the spaghetti sauce? It was called Prego, right? It was Prego. Prego because it's in me, right? It's in there, right? Prego, it's in there. Here's what I thought. It's in me. Now pray and go. Never mind. It's in me. Pray and go. Come on. There's something about you tonight. It's praying and going. Why? Because it's in me. I think you wrote this, right, Jason? It's a song that Jason wrote. And here's what it says. Let my life be an extension of your love. Would you worship with us as a dismissal prayer right now? Sing these words. Do we have the words? Do they have them? All right. Let's do this. That's okay.
Let my life be an extension of your love. Let my life be an extension of your love.
Come on, sing it out.